Hey everyone, it's ariesjj back with you. Today, continuing on with our build tutorial progression, we're going to be covering the fuse Clapton. Now, the fuse Clapton in Jest is similar to that of the regular Clapton that you may be familiar with, but instead of using a single core wire, we're going to be using two or more cores and then fusing it together with a smaller gauge wire such as, you know, 36, 38, whatever. For ease of simplicity, we will be doing a two-core fuse Clapton today. Now, I will be showing you two different methods. I'll have timestamps down below so you can skip to whichever method that you want, but by all means, definitely check out both and find out what works for best for you. The first method that we'll be showing today is what I call the freehand method. You know, it's just simply using your hand, the wires, the drill, and just going at it. The second method is what some people are calling the Beadlon Spooltamer method. Some are calling it the auto feed method. I'm not sure what the full name is, what the actual name is, but I'll be showing you how to do that one as well. So let's go ahead and pop on over to the build station and check out to see exactly what you're going to need for this. Okay, so first and foremost, we're definitely going to need wire. Now today I will be using 26 gauge Canthal for the cores, and I'll be using 316 stainless for my wrap wire. By all means, use whichever wire you're more comfortable using. Definitely going to need a drill. For the Beadlon Spooltamer method, you're going to need, well, Beadlon Spooltamers. So I'll show you how to set that up. It's also going to be recommended for the Beadlon Spooltamer to take the base out of an old coil for like a CE4 or something like that, because it's going to help guide that wire on there. You're also going to need some pliers to help straighten the wire. You're going to need something to cut your wire, wire snips, scissors, whatever the case may be. Ceramic tweezers, while not required, do help with the installation process. You're going to need your cotton and your scissors for your wicking. Whatever tool is necessary for your RDA installation, something to wrap the coil around. I'll be using the Coilmaster 2.5 millimeter mandrel. Of course, you'll need your ohm meter to check your ohm levels, and definitely in your RDA that you're going to mount it in. So with that being said, let's go ahead and pop on over to Steam Engine and we will check out to see what the ohm level is going to be that we're going to be needing to build today. Okay, so here we are on the Steam Engine website. We're going to pop on into the Wire Wizard. And since we're going to be using a fuse Clapton, for the wire builder, as I showed you during the Steam Engine tutorial, you can come in here and you can pick basically any style setup that you want. Since the fuse Clapton is technically just a Clapton with two cores, we're going to go ahead and use that. Now for the cores, again, it's two cores, so we're going to set it up as a parallel, and we're definitely using Canthal, so we're going to leave the Canthal settings alone, but we are going to change our gauge away from the 30 gauge and change that over to 26, and we're going to do that with both cores. Now, if you're using something else, obviously put in your own values here. For our wrap wire, again, I'm using 316L stainless steel, and I'm using 36 gauge for it. So to figure out what ohm level we're going to roughly end up at, we need to put in our coil setup information. Now, I will be using a 2.5 millimeter mandrel, and I'm going to use roughly, I'm going to go ahead and use 6 wraps for this. So let's go ahead and change this wrap count to 6, leaving the leg length and the wrap spacing as default settings. Now we can see that the resistance for this coil is going to come out in a single coil setup about a 0.43, 0.44. Since I'll be running this in a dual coil setup, we're going to take that number and cut it in half, and that's going to come out with approximately a 0.22. Again, these numbers aren't set in stone, but they are a good guidepost. Now understand that when you have wrapped your coil initially, it's going to ohm much lower than what the actual final ohm level, what the final resistance level is going to be. So take that into account. Make sure that you have it above the minimum resistance value that your mod will accept. So let's go ahead and get things started. We're going to pop back over to the build station and get this going. Okay, so I'm going to use a swivel setup for this because it just makes it a lot easier. instead of cutting, you can cut off two individual strands for this and just hook them up to your swivel system or run them free, whatever you like. For the time's sake and simplicity's sake, I'm just going to cut off a single strand of my core wire. And since this is going to be for a dual coil setup, I'm going to need give or take about 18 inches. So I'm just going to pull that about 18 inches or so. That should be good. Let's give that cut right there. Let's go ahead and get that out of the way. Now, depending on how curled up your wire is, you may want to straighten it to make it easier. I'm going to go ahead and straighten this one just for the giggles of it. Just put in one side into the chuck of your drill. Let's go ahead and pull that back. Grab the other side with a pair of pliers. Pull it tight and just give it a few spins. Doesn't take much. And just kind of run your fingers down it. And when you get to the pliers, let go with the pliers, but keep a hold with your fingers. And when you release, that tension will release in a controlled manner in your fingertips. Because if you just let go with your pliers, right here at the end can curl up and get this little wave effect from the tension release. So that way you don't have to worry about dealing with that. Now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to fold this in half. There we go. Just run my fingers down and just going to give it a little crimp here at the end to act as a loop for my swivels to grab a hold of. There we go, and just hook that onto the swivel. Now, I've got my wrap wire set up over here, just back behind the camera view. It's just sitting upright, you know, like this, to where it can freely roll and release the amount of wrap wire that I need. That way I don't have to cut off any specific length. It'll just, I can use just exactly what I need. So I'm just going to wrap it around the core wires just to let it grab onto it in the chuck. Let's go ahead and screw it into the chuck of the drill. Tighten it down. And just pull tight. Now, the plus with doing a fused Clapton is if you get your spacing off, you can just back up the drill and remove those wraps, get it tighter. And keep going. Same thing if you happen to backtrack over what you've already wrapped, you can back those off as well. It's a very forgiving build. What I'm gonna do is I've got my wire at right about a 90 degree angle from the core wires coming out, and that's gonna allow it to basically wrap itself as tight as I need it to be. If you want to back angle it just a bit, you can definitely do that. That's gonna allow it to be even a tighter wrap. If you can't get this angle just right, by all means, what you can do is brace the cores with your fingers and just hold the wire close to 90 degrees with your thumb and wrap it like that. I just find it better to freehand it off, because if you wrap with your finger right there on the cores, you're going to get a little bit more twist in your finished wire. So I'm going to go ahead and just finish wrapping this up. Let me go ahead and fast forward on here so you guys aren't having to watch the entire part of this. Hopefully it'll fast forward. We'll find out in post edit. Okay, and now that we're down here at the end, we're just going to cut the wire off right here at the cores. And you can see that we've got a little bit of twisting action. Let me try to focus this in a little bit better on that wire. Let's see, set that to manual. There we go. So you can see that we've got, you know, a little bit of twisting right here, a little bit down here. If that happens, which, I mean, it's obviously not bad in this, and it'll probably wrap out very evenly, but you can take a pair of toothless pliers, nylon pliers, and just grab a hold of the core wire and just give it a couple little spins and work those twists out. And there we go. So let me go ahead and pause this right here. I'll get set up for the betalon method, and we'll show you how to cover that. Okay, so I went ahead and got my core wire prepped up. I don't see the point in having to go through that twice. Just, you know, save a little bit of time. So for the betalon method, what you're going to need is you're going to need one of these betalon tames or spool tamers. Now, depending on the size of your spools, obviously the kidney puncher 1,000-foot spools are pretty hefty. So if that's the case, just take these come with a little tie-off on here just to add a little loop for some reason. I guess, you know, if you don't need them real big, you can just leave them on there. But for the kidney puncher, you really want to cut that off to where you can get the full size of the betalon tamer. And you can see that it's got a little hole right here, and you're going to feed your wire through that. Now, I've already got this one prepped up. You want enough tension to where it's not going to just free fall and just go all over the place, but you don't want it so tight that you can't actually pull your wire through. So using the base of a clear miser coil, a CE4 coil, you know, something like that, all you're going to do is you're going to run your wire through the middle of that core, or through that coil base, and bring it out on the other side. Now, what you're looking for is you want one, if I can get this to focus in, let me try to turn on the auto or the manual focus. What you're wanting is a coil that's got this little notch right here to it. And your core wires are going to just kind of feed into that notch and keep them steady while the wire feeds through that hole. So that's the type of coil base that you're wanting to look for. But you're going to take that wire and you're going to feed it through that hole. Let me get this in here. Let's feed it through. And you're just going to let it sit on top of that betalon. And just kind of feed that wire into the chuck of your drill. Get it in here. Now, I'm not a huge fan of this method, but I know a lot of people have been asking how to do it. But yeah, so all I'm going to do is I'm just going to kind of manually feed it a little bit just to kind of get it away from the chuck of that drill. Okay, and then once you get it away from the chuck of the drill and get some clearance, all you're going to do is just get it seated into that slot and just let it go. Just go full blast and it will feed itself and get itself pretty tight. There we go, and we're just gonna let it run on down. Here in just a second, as soon as this is finished, I will get a macro shot side by side of the freehand method and this betalon method. So you can see the differences between the two. It does a fair enough job. I just prefer to freehand it. So we've almost got this finished up. And as you can see, I mean, it's keeping up. It's able to support, you know, a spool as big as the kidney puncher spools. So it'll support just about any spool size. It just works a lot better with the smaller spools. So now that we're closer to the end, I'm just going to go ahead and pull off a little extra wire here. And just kind of close it by hand. There we go. And I'm just going to cut off that end right there. I'm just going to leave that a little bit long there at the end for recognition's sake whenever I go to do the macro shot. And again, you can see that it's got, you know, a considerable amount of twisting in here. So I'm just going to take that off the swivel. Just going to use my nylon pliers to get that straightened out. Okay, there we go. Got that straightened out. So I'm going to set this up and I will give you guys a nice macro shot of what they look like side by side. So you can judge, you know, which one, one, works best for you, two, what looks better in the long run. So let me go ahead and pause this here and I'll pull up macro shot. Okay, so we've got a macro shot here. Now, obviously, you know, I haven't cleaned these, so the wire is going to be a little bit on the dusty side just from sitting there. But the top one that we're looking at here is the one that I wrapped by hand. Oops, got a little hair on there. But yeah, the top one is the one that I wrapped by hand. The bottom one down here is the one that was wrapped with the beetle on. You can see there's not a whole lot of difference between them. As far as which one's tighter, I mean, you can see over here, the top one is just a little bit tighter. If I can get my hand in here without cutting a bunch of shadow all over the place, which apparently I'm not gonna be able to, but right over here, there we go. You can see on the right side of your screen, you can see it's a little bit tighter. It's not drastically tighter, but it is a little bit. So it's all a matter of which method you want to use when it comes down to this. If you've got a spool tamer and a spare coil head that you don't mind taking apart to use for this method, go for it. The freehand method is just as quick and just as efficient. A little bit further of a learning curve, but not too terribly much. So let me go ahead and get this wrapped up, coiled up, and we will see how they vape. Okay, so for building, I'm using a 2.5 millimeter mandrel. I'm going to use the Coilmaster 2.5 millimeter mandrel. If you want to use the Coilmaster top cap to wrap this, go for it. If you're doing this for a presentation picture, I don't advise using the top cap because this little gnarled screw that actually does the wrapping on the wire will actually put an indentation on the right-hand half of the coil. So if you're doing this for photo sake, I definitely recommend, actually wrapping it by hand. And it's just as, you know, as simple as just doing your simple wraps. And then you can tighten it up with the Coilmaster cap after you've got it, after you've got the wraps done. So there's our five, and one more makes six. There we go. And then we're just going to use our cap just to kind of push it on there and get that nice last half wrap on there. And then we're going to take this off. I'm going to put a little crook in the coil leg, and I'm going to snip these legs off, and then I'm just going to repeat the process for the second coil. Okay, there we go. And again, we're just going to use the cap just to push it on there and get that nice and tight. Again, crook that leg off to allow it to sit better in the RDA. Now, since this is going to be the first coil that I install, I'm going to pre-trim. I'm going to pre-trim this leg so I don't have any clearance issues when I go to install it when I go to trim the legs. So with the first one, I always use the skip a hole method. So I put my leg to the closest on the outside. I skip the center, the center one, and I go to the closest to the center for the opposite post. So what I end up with is like this, where I've got that missed hole in the middle, and that just allows it to sit more evenly and more centered within the RDA. So I'm just going to take this. I'm going to straighten it up and center it. I'm going to tighten down my negative post. Get it nice and centered before tightening down the positive post. It out just a little bit, and then I'm going to trim those legs. didn't trim that one quite enough. Let me get back in there. There we go. And then I'm just going to repeat the process with the second coil. Tighten down that negative leg. Use that coil master mandrel to center it. Hold it in place while I tighten down the second lead. Okay, there we go. Go ahead and trim that off. And we're all set. Now, I've got this on the USA ohmmeter, the standard edition. So remember, whenever you use this, when you get your initial ohm reading, it is going to ohm out much lower than what it's going to be once you've got it balanced out. But I'm going to go ahead and check this, see what we're ohming out at right now. So we're at right at the 0.2 mark. So with the USA ohm meter, it always reads out three spots. That's why it's bouncing, because it's bouncing between 0.199 and 2.0 or 0.20. So we're just a little bit lower than where we're going to be once we finish it up. So we know that we're safe. We're going to go ahead and take this off of here, get it mounted. I'm using the X-Cube 2 today for the mod. Go ahead and get this. Now, before I go ahead and start pulsing this, I'm going to give you a macro to give you a nice close-up view of what this coil is going to look like once it's installed, and show you the surface area that you're looking at with it. Let me get these all nice and pretty. There we go. So let me go ahead and get you a macro view of this real quick. Okay, so here we got a macro shot of the actual coil itself. You've definitely got plenty of surface area coming all the way across with that, with that extra wrap. The juice is going to channel in between each one, not just between the wraps of the coil itself, but between each one of these wraps on the wrap bar, the Clapton wrap itself, which is going to expand on that flavor and the surface area for the juice to actually vaporize on. So we'll go ahead and pop back out, get this wicked up, and check out to see how it vapes. Okay, so before we start wicking this coil, we're going to want to make sure that these coils are burning evenly. Now, this mod is asking me, is this new coil? Obviously, yes, it is. So I'm going to tell it yes. I'm going to turn the wattage down just a little bit. Whoops, wrong way. And then we're just going to slowly break in this coil, working out any hot spots that happen to pop up. Oops. And of course, it's kind of acting up on me. So I'm going to loosen it and tighten it back up. There we go. Okay, we've got a little bit of a hot spot there, so we're just going to kind of work this out just a little bit. Tighten down those leads. We're going to burn this in nice and slow. Yeah, see, this mod is not wanting to cooperate. It's a little hot. There we go. So let's go ahead and adjust this just a little bit. Turn this down a little bit more. Make sure that you never touch the coils with anything metal while you're heating it. If you have some ceramic rods, by all means, you can use those. Ceramic tweezers, you can use those while you're heating the coil. But do not touch them with anything metal while they're heating, because that'll cause them to short. Okay, give it a little strum. Okay, that side's heating up just a touch quick. And right back out. I'm going even. And there we go. It's glowing nice and even, so I'm going to bump this up just a little bit. Get it up to about 70 watts, which is where I like mine at. And I see the little hot spot right in there. I'm just gonna give it a little stroke with the tweezers, and boom, we're good. And okay, so we're gonna set that off to the side for right now while we get our cotton prepped. We want that to be nice and cool when we go to put the cotton in, so it doesn't scorch it right away. Now for a 2.5 millimeter coil, I like to use a quarter of the width of a Muji pad. So I'm just gonna cut off the strips real quick. And get them prepped up and ready to go. With Muji pads, they have a matted front and back layer to them. To me, it impairs the wicking capabilities of the cotton, so I tend to take those off. You know, if you're using cotton bacon, then you know, just peel off the strip that you need, and you'll be ready to go. Let's get these thin layers off of here real quick. And this should be just about cool enough. Still a little warm. Oops, and there goes our cotton. There we go. Okay, so we're just gonna take this cotton and we're gonna twist it up just a little bit right at the end. And as we're putting it through, we're just gonna give it a slight twisting action to help it work its way through. There we go. I'm gonna pull it all the way through and we're gonna brace that coil with our thumbnail. There we go. And just snip the tails of the cotton to the appropriate length based on which RDA you're using. I don't like to leave my tails too terribly long because I don't want it to impede on the airflow of the RDA. I want to make sure that plenty of airflow gets up underneath the coils to allow for optimal vaping with them. Again, we're just going to give it a slight little twisting action as we push it through. Bracing it with our thumbnail, we're just going to pull it through, give it a little wiggle to see it in place. Snip this tail. And then using a little screwdriver or ceramic tweezers, you know, whatever you have handy, just kind of fluff these tails back out and tuck them nicely into the juice well of your RDA. Making sure to leave plenty of airflow underneath the coil itself. So take your cotton and kind of push it to the edge of the deck. Repeat it on the same side or on the opposite side. Wow, I just totally can't talk today. And there we go. And this is what you're looking for. You want to be able to see cleanly through to the underside of the deck as we can here. You know, I can see all the way through. Same thing with the other side. And that shows me that I'm going to have plenty of airflow underneath that coil. And then we're good to go. All we got to do is just get it juiced up. Okay, so first and foremost, juice the coil so it can start working its way into the center of the coil. And then I like to saturate the tails of my cotton. You don't have to drown it, just get a nice saturation going. Always remember, the more juice you put, especially on these advanced coils, you know, from Clapton's on up, the more juice you put, the more likely you're going to get some spit back on it. So we're just going to break this in, just give it a quick pulse. And what we're doing is we're pulling juice into the center of that coil, into the middle of the cotton, and that's going to keep that that cotton from scorching out. There we go. One more, and we'll be good to go back up to the face cam. Always remember to adjust your airflow. On the Twist & Mrs. Gold AF, I like to keep mine about two-thirds of the way open on both sides. Line your airflow up with your coil and just put it on there and you're good. There we go. So let's pop on back up to the face cam. Okay, so that's the short and sweet on how to build a fused Clapton. It's not difficult. A little bit of time, a little bit of practice, a little bit of wire, you'll get it too. It's just a matter of finding what method works best for you. I've shown you technically three different ways of doing it. So give them a try, see how it works out. Remember, it's not the cigarettes that you smoke, but the ones that you don't smoke that matter. I don't care if you're vaping a 0.1 or a 10 ohm coil. As long as it's safe and it satisfies you, that's all that matters. Because at the end of the day, it's your vaping journey, nobody else's. So I'm going to cut on out of here. Remember, enjoy, but be safe about it.